So these books are directly historical fantasy, whereas the memoirs of Lady Trent are like the real world, but not directly based in history. The Onyx Court books are set in very specific years in real history. They're what I think of as secret history, where the magical element is being kind of slipped into the cracks of what we know, rather than changing the history that we knew. It's more like there are hidden explanations for things. So the concept of the whole series is that there is a fairy court hidden underneath the city of London, which keeps on interfering with mortal events, interfering with the politics of the royal court or of the city. Each book is essentially kind of a standalone, because each one is in a different century. The fairy characters persist from one story to the next, but the mortal characters come and go. They don't live forever. And as a result, each book has a different flavor, because the history changes around them. The city of London is not the same place each time. I had a small bookshelf in my office, about three shelves high, that for Midnight Never Come, the first book, I filled an entire shelf with research books. And as I went through the series, they started taking over more and more shelf space until at the end it was all three shelves and stacked on top. I did a lot of reading into the general life of the period, the specifics of what London was like, certain historical figures that show up in the novels. I would read biographies. I did spot research on specific topics, like the third book is set around the return of Halley's Comet, and so I was reading about astronomy, or I had to read about alchemy, or I had to read about female intellectuals in the time period. So the research list got longer and longer for each book. So the origin of the Onyx Court stuff was a game called Changeling the Dreaming, which is a kind of urban fantasy game. It assumes that you have fairies living in the modern mortal world. And the ideas behind Changeling are that they protect themselves from disbelief, which can kill them, by actually being born into human bodies. So what I did was, and they get born over and over again. They reincarnate, basically, into different human hosts. So the idea for the game that I ran was it started with characters in the modern day remembering the previous lives their characters had lived and realizing they'd been working on something for centuries and now it was time to finish it. One part of that game took place in the Elizabethan period. Each of the players in the game has their own character, and they're basically the protagonists of the story, but then the person running the game, which in this case was me, makes up all the other characters in the story, like all of the secondary people, the antagonists, and so on. So what I did was, two of those characters I had made up, I really liked the story that I had about what had been going on with them, and I decided to use that as the basis for a novel. So it's not quite the same story that we had in the game, but it was inspired by that. I don't know why, but I have a tendency with a number of my novels to have like two main characters. I've done it in almost everything I've written that wasn't the memoirs of Lady Trent. So each of the Onyx Court books has one mortal protagonist and one fairy protagonist. And then, as you said, in Midnight Never Come, you also have Queen Elizabeth and Invidiana, the fairy queen, who are like, you don't get their point of view in the story. You don't really get to see what they're thinking most of the time, but they're really the ones who kind of created the situation that the main characters are having to deal with. And I really don't know why, in general, I gravitate towards having two characters like that. I know in this case it was because I wanted to show both sides of that world. I wanted to show what was happening in the mortal court and what was happening below London. So because the Onyx Court books came out of this role-playing game that I ran, I knew that for the idea I had for the game, I needed a place where there could be at least 700 years of continual occupation in history, which meant that no place in the United States would really work, because we don't have any cities that are 700 years old. You know, there are places that were occupied back then, but then upheavals, etc. I could have set it in any number of cities elsewhere in the world, but London was easy to research because the native language there is English. Most of the sources I needed were in English, whereas if I'd tried to use like Beijing or Baghdad or something, I would have had a lot more difficulty. Thank you.